All right, so we have discussed about different strengthening mechanisms. One is grain boundary strengthening or grain size reduction, solid solution strengthening, and work hardening. We have discussed all these three mechanisms, how they are responsible for increase in strength of the material, and we have also discussed that when you are increasing the strength of the material, you are also going to lose the ductility of the material. You cannot get both. If you increase strength, your ductility automatically goes down. That means by increasing the strength of the material, you are actually making your material more and more brittle. Okay, that is an important consequence of strengthening. So as we have also studied that as you reduce the grain size, so this is grain boundary strengthening. So the grain boundary acts as a barrier for dislocation motion, and hence dislocations goes and gets pinned near the grain boundaries, and hence you need to apply higher stress in order to continue your dislocation motion, and that is how grain boundary strengthening happens. And we have discussed that if you increase the area of grain boundaries in the material, you can actually enhance the strength of the material. So one way to do that is to reduce the size of the grain, right? And that is, what is the meaning of that? So if you keep on reducing the size of the grain, you are going to increase the strength of the material. So that is the reason why the nanocrystalline materials, so for instance nanocrystalline copper and a coarse grain copper, the polycrystalline copper which is coarse grain vis-a-vis a nanocrystalline copper, if you take these two materials, both of them will not give you same strength, because of the fact that the grain size is smaller in nanocrystalline material, you have more grain boundary area, and hence the dislocation, there is a higher probability for the dislocations to go and get pinned near the grain boundary, and hence nanocrystalline materials are stronger. And in other words, people usually call this phenomena as smaller is stronger. So you should not look down upon small things, right? Smaller is harder and stronger. That is very important to know, even in material science. Okay, and then we have also discussed about Hall pitch, that is, as you reduce the grain size, this is the reduction in size of the grain, you are increasing the yield strength of the material, but there is a size about which this Hall pitch relation breaks down, and beyond, if you further reduce the grain size, again the yield strength starts decreasing. Okay, we have discussed that as the inverse Hall pitch relation, and we have also discussed why that is so. Okay, and then we have discussed about solid solution strengthening. So when you put in an impurity element, then actually that locally changes the stress state, and the dislocations have to interact with the stress state. As a result, your material gets strengthened. And we have also discussed the strain hardening or work hardening, both in single crystal material as well as polycrystalline material. In the single crystal material, it is typically the stage 2, wherein when you increase the dislocation density, these dislocations start interacting with each other. So dislocation entanglement might happen, dislocation annihilation may happen, dislocation repulsion may happen. All these interactions will actually impede dislocation motion, and the strengthening is nothing but we have actually defined the process of strengthening as a way of impeding the dislocation motion, right? If you impede the dislocation motion, that will enhance the strength of the material. So all these things impede. So that is why as you continue to increase the strain in the material, there are dislocation density increases and they start to interact, and as a result you are going to have more and more strength for the material. Okay, all right. Now we will look at plastic deformation in polycrystalline materials. In polycrystalline materials, it is a little bit more complex than a single crystal material, because in single crystal material, you first of all you don't have grain boundaries, and the second thing is that you have slip systems in a particular grain, and then those slip systems may interact. But in a polycrystalline material, the slip system, you can have slip, initial slip getting activated on several grains, because you have one slip in a single crystal material, you have one slip system that is favorably oriented typically. But by the fact that you have a polycrystalline materials, it is possible or it is probable that there are more number of slip systems active to begin with. And as a result, it is not possible for you to observe this easy glide so easily in a polycrystalline material. Okay? So easy glide is not something that is usually observed in polycrystalline material. You will have a yield strength and immediately your strain hardening starts because several dislocations in several slip systems or several grains start activating and they start interacting with the grain boundaries and so on. Okay, the hardening kicks in quite early in a polycrystalline material. And you should be able to see why it does so. Okay. And as a result, we have also discussed that the polycrystalline materials are stronger than their single crystal counterparts. So if you make a single crystal copper and a polycrystalline copper, single crystal copper is going to be softer compared to polycrystalline copper because of the impediment of dislocations in a polycrystalline material compared to a single crystal. So this is a micrograph showing the plastic deformation on a polycrystalline material. So these are your slip lines. You will see in a single crystal, in a single grain, you have several slip systems active, right? Some of these things are one slip system and there are other lines like that. So that means in one grain, more than one slip system is active. That is one thing. And there are several grains in which several slip systems are active, right? So all these things can actually be working in concert in a polycrystalline. That is your slip system 1, slip system 2, and so on. The another mechanism that is important in a polycrystalline material is something called cross slip. So, what do you mean by cross slip? So, it typically occurs in stage 3 of deformation at high temperature. So, this is your one slip system, and this is another slip system. So, then the dislocation might actually jump from one guy to another. So, there can be a slip happening from one slip system to another slip system, and this is what we call cross slip. And as we have already discussed, the polycrystals do not exhibit stage 1 of deformation. That is very difficult to observe stage 1 of deformation in polycrystalline. And we have also discussed about work hardening. Because of the multiple slip, then there is going to be more resistance for the dislocation motion. And the relation between shear stress and the dislocation density. So this rho is your dislocation density, right? And alpha is a material parameter. Typically for metals it is between 0.3 and 0.6. And g is your shear modulus. B is your Burgess vector. And then as you continue to load the system, your dislocation density increases, right? Because the number of dislocations are multiplying as you continue to load the system. So because of the fact that the dislocation density is increasing, your shear stress required to cause further deformation increases. And that is how the dislocation density and flow stress in a material are connected. Alright. So far we have discussed about hardening mechanisms. But in materials, it is also possible that there are certain mechanisms which makes the material soft. Right? So under special circumstances, they can undergo softening during plastic deformation. That happens when you have damage. So what do you mean by hardening? The material is becoming more and more stiffer, right? Isn't it? If you see your stress strain response, your elastic stiffness, and then it is becoming to cause same strain, you are actually requiring to apply more stress, right? It is becoming harder. But if you have a damage in the material, that means during the deformation you are imparting damage to the material, and that damage actually is going to reduce the overall elastic stiffness of the material, and that is what you mean by softening the material. So that damage accumulation, one of the mechanisms. This is typically observed in ceramics and composites. And ceramics, you can clearly see that there is no plastic deformation, right? Ceramics fail by damage accumulation, that they typically fail by brittle. And then there is another thing called geometric softening. What do you mean by geometric softening? If it is softening, in other words, actually means that it becomes easier for you to impart dislocation. That is what you mean by softening. Hardening is it becomes easier, difficult for you to impart dislocation. So hindering the dislocation motion is what causes hardening. enhancing the dislocation motion is what causes softening. They are two opposing effects. So now geometric softening means when you are applying a load, some of the slip systems are active, right? And we also know that as you are deforming the material, the slip system orientations are changing. The slip systems will be rotating. And during this process, it is possible that there are more and more slip systems that are changing their orientations in such a way that you are enhancing the dislocation. That means there are more slip systems that are becoming favorable or active because of the geometric orientation changes. And that such a softening mechanism is called geometric softening. Okay? So the individual grains rotate toward crystallographic orientations for which Smith factor is increased. When your Smith factor is increased, then it becomes easier for you to cause plastic deformation or dislocation. And that is what is geometric softening. This typically happens in several materials, but many a times what happens is your hardening effect is more predominant compared to the geometric softening. Even during the hardening response, the crystal orientations are changing, but the effect caused by reorientation of the crystals, the grains, is actually much less compared to the effect caused by the dislocation, the obstacles in the crystal system which are hindering the dislocation. That is why when you are seeing the hardening, you probably won't observe, you will not be able to observe softening. But in some situations, you will have the several slip systems orienting in such a way that the Smith factor is actually going to be much higher. Then you will see a gross softening response of the material. And another way that you can impart softening is thermal softening. What do you mean by thermal softening? When you cause plastic deformation, you are actually creating, so there will be local heat generation, right? And the local heat generation might actually reduce the strength of the material. And that is what we call thermal softening. So the heat generated because of the plastic deformation is what helps the enhancement of the dislocation. And these are the ways, different ways that you can impart softening in a material. Okay. So, this is an interesting question. So, now we are required to calculate the stored energy in copper crystal with a dislocation density of 10 power 11 per centimeter. So, this is the dislocation density. This is typical of a highly deformed material. So, this is actually highly deformed material. Also, so what we need to calculate, what is the energy, what is the total stored energy at the dislocation because of the presence of the system. Also calculate the total deformation energy per unit volume at a strain of 0.5. So if you are applying a strain of 0.5, what is the total deformation energy, and compare this total deformation energy with the energy stored in the dislocation. So, you are taking a material, you are applying some load, and then you are increasing the dislocation density. So, there is an energy associated with the dislocation or not. What is that? How do you calculate the energy associated with the dislocation? Strain energy associated with the dislocation is, it depends on the Burgess vector and shear modulus, right, of Gb square. That is the energy associated with the dislocation, right? So now assume for this material, the shear modulus is this, B is 0.25, that is Burgess vector, 0.25 nanometer. And the work hardening, what do you mean by work hardening? The hardening response that during which the dislocation motion takes place is given by this formula, where sigma naught is 50 MPa, n is your hardening exponent. We will talk about this in a maybe couple of classes later, what is this K and N. This is a functional response of your stress, flow stress, N equal to 0.5 and K equal to 500 MPa. These are the material properties. Okay? So, if you were to calculate the total deformation energy, you need to find out integral sigma times epsilon dV, that is your total deformation energy. You know what is your sigma, and epsilon is going from 0 to 0.5, and that is your total deformation. So, let us try to solve this problem. So, the total dislocation energy per unit volume is half rho Gb square, and this rho is your dislocation density, G is your shear modulus, B is your Burgess. Okay? So the energy comes out to be 1.5 megajoule per meter. That is the energy stored in the dislocation, strain energy due to dislocations that are present in the material. Okay. But these dislocations are caused by imparting deformation to the material, right? So the material's stress strain response is given by this expression, right? So the strain energy in the material is actually integral sigma d epsilon going from 0 to epsilon. So you have you know what is your sigma, and you know to which strain you have actually deformed the material, and you've calculated this integral, evaluate this integral, then you get 1.41 into 10 power 8. That means 140 megajoule per meter. What is the meaning of this? You have deformed a material, and to deform this material to a strain of 0.5, you have put in 140 megajoules per meter cube of energy. That is the total deformation energy. Now, when you have done this, there are some dislocations that are multiplying in the material. So you have got a final dislocation density of 10 power 11 per centimeter square, and the strain energy associated with those dislocations is calculated to be just 1.5 megajoule per meter. Out of 140 megajoule per meter cube, only 1.5 megajoule per meter cube is actually responsible for creating dislocation motion or multiplying. The total energy that is stored in the dislocations is only 1.5 megajoules, which means only 1.4% of the total energy is stored in the dislocations, and the remaining 98.6% energy is dissipated as heat. Right? Not all the work that you are putting in is actually going into creating dislocation. Lot of it is dissipated as heat, and that is precisely the reason why, if you have done your uniaxial tension test, and immediately after the test, if you try to touch the sample will be very hot. And where is this heat coming from? This is the energy that is dissipated as heat. Okay. So the point that you need to understand here is that out of all the energy that you are putting in, not everything is used for dislocation creation. A lot of it is dissipated as heat. Eventually, only some amount of energy is stored as strain energy to be dissipated. Remaining energy is dissipated as heat. Okay? Alright. So, with that, we will close the imperfections. Then we will move on, start another module on mechanical properties.